What are the policy options? There are a number. A narrow policy option from the beginning was to follow the advice of really far-out radicals like the Pope and Vatican immediately said, look, it's a horrible terrorist crime. In the case of a crime, you try to find the perpetrators, you bring them to justice, you try them, you don't kill innocent civilians. Like if somebody robs my house and I think the guy who did it is probably in a neighborhood across the street, I don't go out with an assault rifle and kill everybody in that neighborhood. You know, that's not the way you deal with a crime, whether it's a small crime like this one or a really massive one like the U.S. terrorist war against Nicaragua and even worse ones and others in between. And there are plenty of precedents for that. In fact, I mentioned a precedent, Nicaragua, a law-abiding state, which is presumably why we had to destroy it, which followed the right principles. Now, of course, it didn't get anywhere because it was running up against a power that wouldn't allow lawful procedures to be followed. But if the United States tried to pursue them, nobody would stop it. In fact, everyone would applaud. And there are plenty of other precedents. When the IRA set off bombs in London, which was a pretty serious business, apart from the fact that it was unfeasible, let's put that aside, one possible response would have been to destroy Boston, which is the source of most of the financing, and of course to wipe out West Belfast. Well, you know, quite apart from feasibility, it would have been criminal idiocy. The way to deal with it was pretty much what they did. You know, find the perpetrators, bring them to trial, and look for the reasons. Because these things don't come out of nowhere, you know, they come out of something. And whether it's a crime in the streets or a monstrous terrorist crime or anything else, there's reasons. And usually if you look at the reasons, some of them are legitimate and ought to be addressed independently of the crime. They ought to be addressed because they're legitimate. And that's the way you deal with it. There's many such examples. But there are problems with that. One problem is that the United States does not recognize the jurisdiction of international institutions, so it can't go to them. It has rejected the jurisdiction of the World Court. It's refused to ratify the International Criminal Court. It's powerful enough to set up a new court if it wants, so that wouldn't stop anything. But there's a problem with any kind of a court. Namely, you need evidence. You go to any kind of court, you're going to need some kind of evidence, not Tony Blair talking on television. And that's very hard. It may be impossible to find. You know, it could be that the people who did it killed themselves. Nobody knows this better than the CIA. These are decentralized, non-hierarchic networks. They follow a principle that's called leaderless resistance. That's the principle that's been developed by the Christian right terrorists in the United States. It's called leaderless resistance. You have small groups that do things. They don't talk to anybody else. There's a kind of a general background of assumptions, and then you do it. Actually, people in the anti-war movement are very familiar with this. We just call it affinity groups. If you assume correctly that whatever your group you're in is being penetrated by the FBI, when something serious is happening, you don't do it in a meeting. You do it with some people you know and trust, an affinity group, and then it doesn't get penetrated. That's one of the reasons why the FBI has never been able to figure out what's going on in any of the popular movements. And other intelligence agencies are the same. They can't, you know. That's leaderless resistance, or affinity groups and decentralized networks are extremely hard to penetrate. And it's quite possible that they just don't know. When Osama bin Laden claims he wasn't involved, that's entirely possible. In fact, it's pretty hard to imagine how a guy in a cave in Afghanistan who doesn't even have a radio or a telephone could have planned a highly sophisticated operation like that. Chances are it's part of the background, you know, like other leaderless resistance terrorist groups, which means it's going to be extremely hard to find evidence. The U.S. doesn't want to present evidence because it wants to be able to do it, to act without evidence. That's a crucial part of the reaction. You'll notice that the U.S. did not ask for Security Council authorization, which they probably could have gotten this time, not for pretty reasons, but because the other permanent members of the Security Council are also terrorist states. They are happy to join a coalition against what they call terror, namely in support of their own terror. Like Russia wasn't going to veto it, they love it. You know? So the U.S. probably could have gotten Security Council authorization, but it didn't want it. And it didn't want it because it follows a long-standing principle, which is not George Bush. It was explicit in the Clinton administration, articulated, and goes back much further. And that is that we have the right to act unilaterally. We don't want international authorization because we act unilaterally. And therefore, we don't want it. We don't care about evidence. We don't care about negotiation. We don't care about treaties. We're the strongest guy around, you know, toughest thug on the block. We do what we want. Authorization is a bad thing, and therefore must be avoided. There's even a name for it in the technical literature. It's called establishing credibility. You have to establish credibility. That's an important factor in many policies. It was the official reason given for the war in the Balkans, and the most plausible reason. You want to know what credibility means? Ask your favorite mafia don. I'll explain to you what credibility means. And it's the same in international affairs, except, you know, it's talked about in universities. You do it with big words and that sort of thing. But it's basically the same principle, and it makes sense, and it usually works. The main historian who's written about this for the last several hundred years is Charles Tilly, his book called Coercion and Violence, and he points out that violence has been the leading principle of Europe for hundreds of years, and the reason is because it works. You know, it's very reasonable. It almost always works when you have an overwhelming predominance of violence and a culture of violence behind it. So therefore, it makes sense to follow it. Well, those are all problems in pursuing lawful paths. And if you did try to follow them, you'd really open some very dangerous doors. Like the U.S. is demanding that the Taliban hand over Osama bin Laden. And they're responding in a way which is regarded as totally absurd and outlandish in the West. Namely, they're saying, okay, but first give us some evidence. In the West, that's considered ludicrous. It's a sign of their criminality. You know, how can they ask for evidence? I mean, if somebody asked us to hand someone over, we'd do it tomorrow. We wouldn't ask for any evidence. In fact, it's easy to prove that. We don't have to make up cases. So, for example, for the last several years, Haiti has been requesting the United States to extradite Emmanuel Constant, who's a major killer. He was one of the leading figures in the slaughter of maybe 4,000 or 5,000 people in the years in the mid-90s under the military junta, which incidentally was being not so tacitly supported by the Bush and the Clinton administrations, contrary to illusions. Anyway, he's a leading killer. They got plenty of evidence, no problem about evidence. He's already been brought to trial and sentenced in Haiti, and they're asking the United States to turn him over. Well, I mean, do your own research. See how much discussion there's been of that. Actually, Haiti renewed the request. It wasn't even mentioned. Why should we turn over a convicted killer who was largely responsible for killing 4,000 or 5,000 people a couple of years ago? In fact, if we do turn him over, who knows what he'll say? Maybe he'll say that he was being funded by and helped by the CIA, which is probably true. We don't want to open that door. What about reactions in Afghanistan? The initial proposal, the initial rhetoric, was for a massive assault, which would kill many people visibly, and also an attack on other countries of the region. Well, the Bush administration wisely backed off from that. They were being told by every foreign leader, you know, NATO, everyone else, every specialist, I suppose, their own intelligence agencies, that would be the stupidest thing they could possibly do. It would simply be like opening recruiting offices for bin Laden all over the region. That's exactly what he wants, and it would be extremely harmful to their own interests. So they backed off that one. They're turning to what I described earlier, which is a kind of silent genocide. Well, I already said what I think about it, and I don't think anything has to be said. You can figure it out if you do the arithmetic. A sensible proposal, which is kind of on the verge of being considered, but it's been sensible all along, and is being asked, called for by expatriate Afghans and allegedly tribal leaders internally, is for a UN initiative, which would keep the Russians and the Americans out of it totally. I mean, these are the two countries that have practically wiped the country out in the last 20 years. They should be out of it. They should provide massive reparations, but that's their only role. A UN initiative to bring together elements within Afghanistan that would try to construct something from the wreckage. It's conceivable that that could work with plenty of support and no interference. If the U.S. insists on running it, it might as well quit. We have a historical record on that one. You'll notice that the name of this operation, remember, at first it was going to be a crusade, but they backed off that because PR agents told them that wouldn't work. And then it was going to be infinite justice, but the PR agents said, wait a minute, you're sounding like you're divinity, so that wouldn't work. And then it was changed to enduring freedom. We know what that means, but nobody has yet pointed out, fortunately, that there's an ambiguity there. To endure means to suffer. You know? And there are plenty of other people around the world who have endured what we call freedom. You know? Again, fortunately, we have a very well-behaved, educated class, so nobody has yet pointed out this ambiguity. But if it's done, there'll be another problem to deal with. But if we can back off enough so that some more or less independent agency, maybe the UN, maybe credible NGOs, can take the lead in trying to reconstruct something from the wreckage with plenty of assistance, and we owe it to them, then maybe something would come out. Beyond that, there are other problems. We certainly want to reduce the level of terror, certainly not escalate it. There's one easy way to do that, and therefore it's never discussed, namely stop participating in it. That would automatically reduce the level of terror enormously, but that you can't discuss. Well, we ought to make it possible to discuss it. So that's one easy way to reduce the level of terror. Beyond that, we should rethink the kinds of policies, and Afghanistan's not the only one, in which we organize and train terrorist armies. That has effects. We're seeing some of the effects now. September 11th is one. Rethink it. Rethink the policies that are creating a reservoir of support. Exactly what the bankers and lawyers and so on are saying in places like Saudi Arabia and on the streets. It's much more bitter, as you can imagine. That's possible. You know, those policies aren't graven in stone. And furthermore, there are opportunities. It's hard to find many rays of light in the last couple of weeks, but one of them is that there is an increased openness. Lots of issues are open for discussion, even in elite circles, certainly among the general public, that were not a couple of weeks ago. That's dramatically the case. I mean, if a newspaper like, say, USA Today can run a very good article, serious article on life in the Gaza Strip, there's been a change. The things I mentioned in the Wall Street Journal, that's change. And among the general public, I think there's much more openness and willingness to think about things that were under the rug and so on. These are opportunities, and they should be used, at least by people who accept the goal of trying to reduce the level of violence and terror, including potential threats that are extremely severe, could make even September 11th pale into insignificance.